Pat, thank you for a really wonderful lecture, and we're delighted to have Claire and Gloria here as well. I'm sure there are a lot of questions from the audience. We're really proud to be supporting this work. It's really terrific. One thing, my first to start the questions, I was actually struck. Was aware of the very careful data you have done on the lactobacillus trial in healthy elderly subjects. And what you're seeing is I think, pretty consistent with the presence of the organism at 28 days,
yes,
documentable, slightly differently by different methods, and then its rapid disappearance. And this is quite at slight odds with the notion that one can permanently manipulate the microbiome by, say, fecal transplantation or other thoughts. So I'd be very interested in your thoughts.
Yeah. Well, I can certainly comment that it has indeed seemed like a paradox. And in fact, one of the things I was hugely concerned about was that it seems that it is necessary to continue taking a probiotic, at least to have any effect that we are measuring at this period of time. I know in the pediatric population, and certainly administering the probiotics very close to birth, it may be easier to more permanently establish colonization. But I think this could... Yes, yes, yeah. But I think it also could be a two-edged idea, because we may not actually want these probiotics to be around for life, so it may actually be advantageous that it disappears as well. So
I think you raise an interesting question, and just one other thought, and clearly this is speculation without a whole lot of data behind it, but if you look at some of the protocols for fecal transplants, not unlike what you see with bone marrow transplants, there is often an initial step with high doses of antibiotics, with the effect being to really knock down the numbers of bacteria that are present in the GI tract. So whether that has some role to play in setting the stage for recolonization during a transplant, it certainly seems plausible, but and that may be one way, that may be one difference between what the kinds of studies that Pat was talking about today, but clearly that's speculative.
Yeah, one of the things that I want to add to previous comments too is that it's also a matter of time. The more time that you give these probiotics to the patients, the more time that it's going to take for the bacteria to disappear. So somehow it looks like there's a time of adaptation of that bacteria to the system in order to be maintaining there. And we have seen that in these studies.
Yeah, just along these same lines, what, if anything, do we know about changes in omic data following treatment of, like, antibiotic-associated diarrhea, where at least the lore is that probiotics seem to be useful? Do we know anything about that at this point? In other words, you know, you start with normals and you don't see a change over the long haul, but you start with a disrupted ecology. Is there any evidence of long-term change or short-term change? What happens, or do we know anything?
Yes. As best I understand, I believe there is at least one trial, is that right, Linda, that is analyzing those data right as we speak, but I don't think they've been investigated at least at this level of using the omics technology. So I think it's going to be really fascinating to see how that works. Of course, the really unfortunate thing is that, you know, if people have already got antibiotic-associated diarrhea, they've already got a disrupted microbial ecology, and so you don't quite know where you might end up going back to, because you don't know what they were before. But I think it's going to be very interesting, probably within the next year, would you imagine? 6 months. Yeah, that should be coming out.
Any omics data on colon cancer?
or probiotic use in GI cancers?
I must admit that truly isn't my area of expertise. I do believe there is some information. Are you aware?
Not anything systematic.
Yeah, yeah.
Very ad hoc.
Yeah. Yeah, no, there are some interesting questions being raised in that circumstance. And, I think this is where we've got to be awfully careful. You know, if we're going to move into these other areas, which I think it makes sense to do so, we've got to understand how to use the tools well such that we can get the answers as quickly as possible. But I think it's probably a little bit early to comment on that.
Yes, a question is about the cohousing effect. You mentioned in this paper, Science, last Thursday. I think it is because the mice eat each other's poop.
Yeah.
So that is why they mix. And you mentioned what's happening in our house, probably not.
Yeah, I'm just a tad worried that people don't always wash their hands quite as well as they should. But I do agree with you.
There was a very nice piece in the New York Times Magazine by Michael Pollan, and he cited a paper claiming that households with dogs shared their microbiome greater than households without dogs. And perhaps Claire knows the work, but it is clear that we tend to probably share our microbiomes in our families, at least to some degree. Go ahead.
Hi, Dr. Hibberd. It is a nice talk. This is Siva Bhattacharya. You mentioned about the downregulation of IG by FCR2. FCR2 present in which organism and how it downregulate and what level it downregulate? Can you please elaborate a little bit?
I think, Gloria, this is for you.
Okay. Yes, when we look at the analysis of the transcriptome of these patients, we were trying to see the fold changes that were present on the genes. And one of the genes that came significantly different, that was downregulated, was the FCR2, which is the low affinity receptor that is involved in the induction of IgE production. And as you know, is also associated with the initiation of allergic responses in patients. The level that we found of difference is a very low level. It was a 1.8 fold. So when you interpret this data under the biological application, typically a twofold, 1.5 twofold is not that big of a change. But one of the things that was consistently, as we analyzed the data and we did all the filterings, is that this gene popping out. So this is interesting, and this is something that is going to be validated further, because as Dr. Hibberd mentioned, there are also some other studies coming behind this one where we have larger populations, and we are going to be able to validate and see if this is consistent, because, you know, it's a small group of patients too.
It's very interesting.
Yeah.
Dr. Sorkin.
One question about the micro ecology. What about the role of bacteriophage in to what extent might that account for some of the individual differences in variability in microbiome and in the effects of probiotics? And I think people are starting to look, but I was wondering.
Yeah, I think that's another excellent point that you raise, and I think we clearly have to take this into consideration as we're looking at this as a complete ecosystem. We generated some data from our metatranscriptomic studies that Dr. Hibberd didn't have time to show, and we were able to find a lot of transcripts that map back to known viruses and phage in the databases. They tended, though, to look most like viruses that may have been associated with diet, but of course there's always a population of unknowns in each of these groups of data that we can only speculate at this point what they might be doing, but you're absolutely right. There's no way to fully understand what's going on without taking all of this into account as well.
Hi, Barbara Jaratana in NGMS. I really like your commentary, but I will add that the methods that you introduce are limited. transcriptomics is not a good way to look at function. Oftentimes, there's not a good correlation between function because proteins are co-regulated by post-translational modifications, small molecules, and a variety of other mechanisms. So I wish that in the next time, next talk, you would add more functional and chemical aspect to it. But I completely agree, all aspects of biology and medical issues should be considered in looking at the microbiome.
And so it's even more complicated than Pat's excellent scheme.
I totally agree with you. I think, honestly, we're really early in the analytics at this stage, and you're right, we haven't exploited these data to the level that we need. We've got to go across the entire spectrum, so
yeah, but strongly agree. It's past RNA, it's past transcriptome, it's proteins and chemicals.
Yes.
Thank you for this excellent talk. With my limited knowledge, I was confused before this talk, and now I am confused more.
Uh-oh.
So could you please give your advice to those who regularly use probiotics in their diet? Any advice, you know? Thank you.
This really is a tough one. And I must admit, as a practicing physician, I get a lot of questions about, well, should I take a probiotic? Should I not take a probiotic? And unfortunately, I'm just not sure that we know enough to reliably suggest that people are going to benefit for sure from probiotics. And when I say that, people get very angry, but you're studying it. You know, what's wrong with you? But the real issue is I just don't think we have enough information. One thing I'm pretty sure about, though, is that most of the probiotics that are in widespread use that are high-quality products are safe. People are not having bacteremias or invasive infections or any other unexplained event in huge numbers. If it seems like they are beneficial in one's diet, and one is comfortable with that, I certainly would not recommend against it. But it is hard if somebody's saying, should I take a probiotic to do X? Truthfully, I don't think we have the answer yet. So I apologize. I wish I could give an answer to your great question. I think it's going to take a little bit more time before we know how to use probiotics effectively.
Pat has worked very hard with the FDA to develop approaches to the regulation of these products with a lot of assistance from Linda Duffy. And you can see that as a food safety regulator, this would be posing all sorts of complicated issues because, after all, you can't cook it and make it sterile. And similarly, the regulatory structure for administering living organisms has grown up around vaccines and isn't totally an ideal fit for the problems faced here. So we're actually pleased that the FDA has been working closely with our investigators to get at least some of the safety steps, but it is complex. But when NCAM is asked about this issue, we try to avoid giving a lot of health advice, turn to people like Pat to ask what they would say to this question. I think the evidence-based reviews do suggest that probiotics are helpful for antibiotic-induced diarrhea, or at least not harmful. And the pediatricians consider them to be appropriate mechanism to prevent necrotizing enterocolitis in certain groups of premature children. That's, I think, what my simple summary of the state of the evidence would be. Okay, well, it's a great audience, but wonderful talks. And thank you so much, Pat.
Thank you.